So this is a topic that I've actually been pretty fascinated with the last couple of months, particularly because I've always been concerned with my relationship with other people. And for the last 2 weeks, I've personally gone through a few books regarding companionship. The specific presentation today is really going to be a review of one chapter of a book called The Duties of Brotherhood by Imam Ghazali. Hopefully, that doesn't sound too boring for all of you. So, for the introduction, the translator, Mahdar Holland, talks about post-modernity being a time where we live in a moment of hyper-connectivity, where we know so many people, but for some reason, there's a level of quality that we're yearning for that we can't find. He says that we live in a sort of like earthly spaceship. It's the only thing that we have in common with each other. For some reason, we can't find a tangible, real relationship now. And to an extent, he's kind of right. Like, for some reason, I find myself having like 1,469 friends. But on a day-to-day, I probably only speak to like maybe like 3 or 4 on a given instance. And it can actually be probably proven anthropologically as well. The Dunbar number is something that Robin Dunbar, he talks about in any instance, an individual will probably only have, in reality, 150 people that they consistently think about. And he says so because he's argued that our brains have developed in such a way that can only take in consideration of the thoughts and feelings and emotions of 150 people. And to an extent, there's just probably some reality to that, and that's probably why that there's a feeling of expectation to have some sort of connection with so many people, because quote unquote, we know so many people, 14 people, 69 friends that I have heard. But there's an inability to actually meet that expectation. And don't worry, I've come prepared. All of it, actually. Yeah, I agree with you. Now, traditionally, though, in Islam, one of the things we have to understand that while evolution, like within evolution, our brains are only capable of so much, we also believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the fatah, that it is the opener, and that if you invoke Him and you have a true belief in Him and you call upon Him, He will open things for you. And if you have a necessary and deliberate desire to connect with like more people, then He'll give that to you. And this is Sheikh Hamza, in the roots of our crisis, he talks about this specifically, that if you have a desire for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open your heart, open your intellect, then He'll give it to you. Now on to the duties. Imam Ghazali rahimahullah writes that the Sharia itself is not just an obligation that we have to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We all know, everyone here, that we have to pray 5 times a day. When it comes to Ramadan, we have to fast 30 days. It's something that we are obligated, it's a duty that we have to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But in Islam, we also have duties to other people. The Sharia is something that requires us to have a relationship and have a contract amongst each other to do things for others. He talks here that brotherhood or companionship, it's something that's like marriage to an extent, which is not an nikah, and some of you guys are probably like, oh, marriage, so I'm not sure. Even though it's not actually a nikah, within our moments of companionship, there is a social contract that we have, meaning that there are specific duties that we have towards each other. In the book, he has 8 duties specifically that he talks about that we should be doing for each other, these obligations. I was only allowed to do it in 5 minutes. I'm still probably going to go over. So for this talk, we're only going to do 1. And that duty specifically is the dua. And Imam Ghazali rahimahullah, he says that you should pray for him as you pray for yourself, making no distinctions between you and him. For in reality, your prayer for them is a prayer for yourself. And he says that one of the things that we should be doing on a day-to-day basis, if we like, truly want to connect with other people, is to make dua for them. Because one of the ways we can actually truly connect with other people is to consistently think about them. And the best way of thinking about them is making dua for them. And like that's all beautiful and pretty, like, oh, should you go out for someone, I should go out for the world. So how do you practically do this? One of the things that I always suggest to people, and I try to do for myself, is to make a dua list. Obviously here it's a little censored because like, well, some things are really not personal. But to deliberately write out du'as you have for other people. And this is just one of the notes, like note-taking apps that I have. And when Imam Zahra actually says that it's not a du'a that you do for someone else, like, oh, ya Allah, make sure Allah has a good life. Like, that's not a du'a that you would make for yourself. He says that you make a du'a so deliberate, it's as if you're making a du'a for yourself. And what I mean by making sure that you write it within detail, so you understand explicitly and deliberately what that other person wants, that you actually do so. You write out who that person is, and what that person's going through, and what that person needs from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and yourself. It's a very simple thing. And with that, either every day, or every week, or every month, however many times, make it consistent, and you make dua for these people. You keep adding to the list whenever you need. So, we understand that this is something that's necessarily obligated upon us, but why? So there's a hadith of Abu Darda, he's a sahaba. It's a hadith that's narrated by his wife. And his wife is actually saying that Abu Darda used to have about 360 friends. And he would remember each and every single one of them in his du'as, specifically after prayer. And he mentions that when he was asked, Ya Abu Darda, why do you make dua for so many people? He responded by saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually assigns two angels to pray with you. And they actually say to you the same as we've asked for your friend. Meaning that every single time you make dua for someone else, you have two angels giving you or making the same dua for you as well. The perspective. This is a couple of ayahs specifically talking about Yawm al-Qiyamah. And on Yawm al-Qiyamah, one of the realities of Yawm al-Qiyamah is that it's going to be a reality, it's going to be a system of reality where the only person that you'll be, like, you'll actually be thinking of, the only person that you're going to be concerned about is yourself. It's a moment where every person will flee from their siblings, a mother from their children, a father from their children, a brother from their children. And it's a moment where you won't be given the opportunity to actually care about someone else. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually says in Hadith Qudsi that when you're on Yawm al-Qiyamah, there'll be a point when you realize amongst yourself, when within yourself, that you have to go to other people, that you might need to talk to someone else. And at every point where you're going to people that you know, because you'll be lined up in Yawm al-Qiyamah next to people that you know, they'll see you, and they'll look at you, and they'll simply say, I know you need help, but I really gotta consider myself right now. Like, you're on your own. So the opportunity that we have right now is the opportunity to truly make dua for one another. Because we won't get the chance otherwise. But there's an exception. The Prophet says that one of the true signs of the end of times is that very few of us will actually have true friends. And he says that a true friend is one that's willing to pull himself apart in order to pull yourself together. So I know like this topic is a little heavy, so I'll try to end on a pretty good note here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Hadith Qudsi that on Yawm al-Qiyamah there will be two true friends that will stand next to each other. And they'll look at each other and they'll realize that they don't have enough good deeds to actually make it a Jannah. And one will look at the other and say, look, it probably doesn't make sense for both of us to go to hell. So you take my good deeds, and maybe, right, with our good deeds combined, one of us can make it a Jannah. And from this action alone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will see this and enter both of them into Jannah. But the condition for this is to actually be true friends with each other. That you do this understanding that those two individuals were true friends in the dunya. So, we're talking about dua. And I might take a little bit longer, so sorry for some. But in these closing moments, I'd like to ask you want to make you out of. And in these moments, raise your hands, be present mentally, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. Make dua as if you believe in a God that is hearing your prayers. Make dua from your heart and understand that our collective prayer will only be as powerful and impactful if each individual who is in this room is fully present as possible. This is a dua from actually Imam Khalid. Allahumma ameen, Allahumma anta salam, aminka salam, tabarakti ya dhal jalali wal ikram. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina mawlana habibina Muhammad wa ala ali sayyidina Muhammad. كما صليت إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وفي الأولين وفي الآخرين. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا اجعلنا من المخلصين. ربنا اجعلنا من المخلصين. ربنا اجعلنا من المخلصين. يا الله, our Lord, most merciful of those who show mercy, instill within us our courage to start this day. Our struggles are real, but your promise is true. Indeed, with hardship there will always come ease. Remove from our hearts any fears or inhibitions and replace them with an ever-increasing boldness to live each moment as best as we can. Grant us the courage to express our feelings, to let those that we love know how valuable they are to us, to seek forgiveness from those that we have wronged, and to exert mercy towards those who have wronged us. The burdens of life sometimes seem so heavy to bear. The anxiety, the anguish that sits inside of us feel bigger at times than the world around us. O Allah, give us audacious hearts that overcome the pain inside. Hearts that help us to carry each burden with ease, regardless of how heavy it seems. Make us not amongst those who are sheltered from life's realities, but rather amongst those who are not afraid to face them. Bring people into our lives that we love so much that our love for them moves us to be courageous but not foolish. People that we love so much that our dedication to their well-being is rooted in wisdom and mindfulness. Make us people who find strength in selflessness but not selfishness, sincerity and not self-centeredness. Grant us the courage to stand again after we have fallen, to find meaning in our failures and to keep moving forward no matter what is trying to push us down. Grant us the courage to put our trust in you, whether we understand or not, and the courage to recognize and feel the depth of our love. Help us to harness that love and utilize it to illuminate the darkest of places that we might have to venture, both in the world around us and the world that are in us. Grant us the courage to live our own lives, to understand our role in the writing of our own stories, to make decisions with foresight and insight, and before each step we take in the world, to remember that we have life in the world beyond this one. Grant us the courage to forgive ourselves and to live a life in pursuit of true contentment. The courage to ask you to remove from our lives anything that distracts us, anything that makes us complacent or satisfies our wants at the expense of our real needs. Love your creation through us. Be gentle to them through us. Increase them in strength through us. Give them courage through us. Help them grow through us. Endow them with confidence through us. Fill them with sincerity through us. And protect them through us. And bring good and benefit to the rest of us in this world, most merciful of those who show mercy. Let our anger only be at injustice, oppression, and exploitation of people, so that we will work for justice, equality, and peace. Let our tears shed only for those who suffer from pain, rejection, starvation, and conflict, so that we will reach out our hands to comfort them and change their pain into joy. Let our success be many as we make difference in this world by doing the things that others say that cannot be done. You are always with us, Ya Allah. Help us on this day to recognize your presence, and through it give us courage to meet the challenges on this day and those of every tomorrow that we will see. Protect us always, Ya Allah, from hearts that are not humble, tongues that are not wise, and eyes that have forgotten how to cry. Forgive us for our shortcomings and guide us and bless us all. رَبِّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ آمِينَ يَا رَبَّ الْعَالَمِينَ السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.